There is a revolution in British brewing. More breweries, more ambition, and bigger flavours than in most of our lifetimes. Beer is simply natural. It is malt, hops, yeast, and water. And it all starts with barley, harvested for beer to be turned into malt. It is steeped, soaked, to germinate. Alongside the new, the old ways are still used.
I think the art of malting is being able to pick or choose a high quality malting barley from any given crop, and then being able to control the process to produce what we would consider to be a high quality malt. And the maltster's art is to try and be as consistent as possible for his brewing customer, whose own customers do not want the taste of their favourite pint to change. To make sure that the grain is ready for kilning, I take a sample of a grain. I like to nip the end off with my thumb, and then I rub it between my thumb and forefinger until I get a nice creamy white line, and that is known as the maltster's chalk.
After germination, kilning, drying, and to get many flavours and colours, roasting.
It's quite a old piece of kit, this. The one I have in the office belonged to my great-grandfather, so they do last a long time. But what I'm trying to establish is whether this has been roasted correctly or not. And the blade will come through the middle of it, and you can now see it is very even, it isn't burnt, there's no carbon there, and that's a proper roasted malt.
James is the seventh generation of Fawcett's malting at Castleford in Yorkshire. He's never been busier. 20 years ago, he made 5 styles of malt. Today, it's 29.
Our job is to buy the best barley available from every season, to turn it into the best malt we possibly can, and then it's over to the brewer.
The grist, pale and coloured malts, maybe wheat or oats. Mixed with hot water, it's like porridge. This is the mash. At the right temperature, sugar is extracted and flushed out by sparging. What's left, spent grain, goes for cattle feed. Every brewery needs a farmer. The sugary liquid, the wort, now needs hops for bitterness, flavour and aroma.
I'm a hophead. I love anything. I love very hoppy beers. I know within this market people are willing to try anything, so we're able to push the boundaries more. So we can use more hops, more flavour that people aren't used to, you know. Traditional bitters with more floral character, and it's the joy to be in the business at the moment.
Oh, wow, that is fantastic. Sends a shiver down the back of your neck. Just what the brewer is looking for. Flavours that really entice and intoxicate you. Wonderful. 22 years ago, when I started in this industry, we stocked 3 varieties of hops. We're now stocking over 70 different varieties. We're looking for more intensity of flavour, more quality of aroma, more quality of flavour. It really is important to get the best flavours out we possibly can. In my opinion, hops have never been as important as they are now in beer making. The flavours that are coming from some of the beers, the American IPA styles that have come from the US, the English IPAs that we've now improved upon, we've increased the flavour, the hop quality within these beers. There's a plethora of new flavours that we're experiencing, and it really is challenging people to come in and enjoy more beer. It's fantastic. Brewers these days are now looking for new things all the time. We're looking for something different, something that's going to challenge the drinker, something that's going to give us an experience and not just a seat at the bar with a pint of beer.
To give bitterness and flavour, hops are added to the boiling wort. And then into the fermentation vessel where yeast is pitched. Yeast turns sugar into alcohol, if it feels like it.
Yeast is alive, and it's a single cell organism that has a memory. You treat it bad once, it's going to remember. So we try to treat it and look after it as best as possible, which in turn repays the favour. We get healthy fermenting beers, they ferment within time, and our beer tastes wonderful at the end of it.
Fermentation takes a week, then into conditioning tanks. It's now beer.
We leave it there for 2 to 3 days, depending on what style of beer. If it's light, hoppy, it may only last 2 to 3 days, or until the yeast counts right, so the beer drops nice and bright and causes no problems for the landlords out there. And once we're happy with the flavour profile we're getting in the conditioning tanks, we decide then it's time to rack into casks.
The taste is sharp and zesty on the front of your palate, and then at the back there is a softness as well as a lovely, beautiful tropical fruit aftertaste with it as well. That flavour goes all the way through the taste sensation, which is lovely. We know exactly where the flavour of that beer is coming from because it's all over this hop. So the malts here are not just giving us this beautiful red colour, but also giving us this lovely, malty, wholesome flavour as well. This is a dark porter. All colour, it's all about colour and flavour, and roasted flavours in particular. And that's coming from a mixture of these malts. Really, really dark chocolate malt there. And that you can see just translate absolutely into the colour of the liquid in the glass.
It's almost like being a chef. You sniff, you smell, you taste throughout the whole process. You take the barley at the start, you try it, you taste it, sniffing the hops constantly, and everything in our process is manually done. We have no automation, so all the ingredients are handled at every time. So if any of the raw ingredients aren't up to our quality, they're rejected, because all we're after is the finest raw ingredients to produce the most perfect pint we can.